Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to Biology. Starting with today's lesson, we are going to do a deep dive into the major organ systems of the human body, starting with the skeletal and muscular systems. You might be wondering how the skeletal system is an organ system, but believe it or not, bones and muscles are organs. These two systems work together to move your body, both voluntarily and involuntarily. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to explain the structure and function of the skeletal and muscular systems. Discuss how the systems work together to move the body. Did you know that the human body has over 200 bones? These bones range from the tiny bones that make up your inner ear to the large femur bone in your thigh, which is said to be stronger than concrete. Working together, your skeleton provides the internal frame for your body. It helps muscles move, provides shape and structure to your body, and protects your organs. The skeletal system is composed of bones and connective tissues, such as ligaments and tendons. For example, the anterior cruciate ligament in the knee, more commonly known as the ACL, or the Achilles tendon in the heel. While we often think of the main job of bones being support and structure, they are also responsible for storing minerals and producing red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets. Bones are usually broken into four categories based on their shape: long, short, flat, and irregular. Long bones are exactly like they sound. They are longer than they are wide, with a shaft and two ends. This includes obvious bones like the femur in your leg and the humerus in your arm. It also includes the bones in your fingers. Short bones are more cube-like in shape. They are the bones found in your foot and hand that allow you to move your ankle and wrist. Your patella or kneecap is also a short bone. Flat bones are made of thin sheets of bone tissues. Think of your ribs or the bones in your skull. Finally, if any bones don't fit into the previous three categories, they get added to the irregular bones category. An example would be the vertebrae in your spine. As we have learned in previous units in biology, prefixes mean a lot. This is still true when we are discussing the human body. Have you ever heard of the condition osteoporosis? It usually affects older adults, but is a condition in which bone density decreases, causing the bones to become brittle. The prefix osteo refers to bones. Keep that in mind as we learn about the three main cells that make up bones. Osteocytes are mature bone cells that live in fully formed and matured bones. Osteoblasts are immature bone cells that work to grow new bones. And finally, osteoclasts are bone cells that work to break down and dissolve the bone tissue to make room for new, younger, healthier bone cells. Osteoblasts and osteoclasts work in a cycle to ensure healthy and strong bones. I want you to imagine a sushi roll. When it is made perfectly and you slice it, you can clearly see the layers of rice, seaweed, and fillings. Your long bones are built in a similar way, with clearly delineated layers. There are four main layers that make up a long bone. Starting from the outside and working towards the center of the bone, the first layer is the periosteum. This is a soft, thin layer that contains nerves and blood vessels and protects the bone. Directly underneath the periosteum is the compact bone. This is the hard outer surface of the bone, and interestingly enough, it can heal itself when it is broken. Below the compact bone is the spongy bone. It has this name because it resembles a sponge. It is weak, easily fractured, and contains bone marrow, which is our final layer. Bone marrow is soft and spongy and fills the gaps in the spongy bone. It is where blood cells are made and is located in the medullary cavity. If you're able to, I want you to bend your arm at your elbow. Okay, now if you can, reach your arm up over your head. Finally, if you can, turn your head from side to side like you're nodding no. All of these motions involve moving your bones at joints. A joint is the location where two or more bones meet. How we move our bones, we will get to later in this video, but right now, I want you to just focus on the location of the movement. There are three types of joints in the human body: fixed joints, or joints that prevent movement. These joints are mainly in between the bones in your skull. Next, we have semi-movable joints, which, as their name tells you, allows for limited movement, like the vertebral column and the rib cage. Finally, we have movable joints, which provide for a wide range of movements and contains most of the other joints in your body, like your knee. Movable joints can be further categorized by how the bones move. Imagine bending your arm at your elbow. That movement is a hinge joint. Another place where you will find hinge joints is in your fingers. These joints move like a hinge in one direction, but are strong. Picture a softball pitcher. When she swings her arm around in a circle, she is moving her shoulder. Your shoulder and hips are examples of ball and socket joints. If someone is nodding yes or no, they are moving their neck. You may even say they are pivoting their neck. This is an example of a pivot joint. Now, imagine flexing your hand back and forth at your wrist, or walking slowly from heel to toe. The joints in your wrist and hands, or foot and ankle, are gliding joints. In gliding joints, your bones slide over one another. When you look at this image of the pelvic area of a skeleton, you will notice rope-style structures that connect bones. These are called ligaments. Ligaments are tough bands of tissue that connect bones. One of the most famous ligaments is the anterior cruciate ligament, or the ACL, in your knee. This ligament helps to stabilize your knee, but a torn ACL is a common injury in athletes. When most people think about muscles, what they are actually thinking about are skeletal muscles. However, skeletal muscles only make up approximately a third of the muscles in your body. The rest of the muscles are smooth muscles and cardiac muscles. Skeletal muscles, such as your triceps and biceps, are connected to bones by tendons. Muscle cells are elongated, striated cells with multiple nuclei. In order to form muscles, these cells are grouped together into dense bundles and bound together by connective tissue. Skeletal muscles are referred to as voluntary muscles because you are able to move them at will. Smooth muscles are also called involuntary muscles because they contract involuntarily. You don't control them, they just work on their own. These muscles line the walls of internal organs such as your stomach and intestines. They are long and tapered in shape and are smooth and not striated. Together, these cells line up to form sheets. The final type of muscle is very important and very specific. The cardiac muscles are the muscles that form the walls of the heart. They are responsible for the pumping action of the heart. Their cells are a combination of skeletal muscles and smooth muscles in that they are striated, tubular, and branched, but only contain one nucleus and contract involuntarily. Luckily, you don't have to think about your heart beating. It just does it on its own. The muscular and skeletal systems work together to move our bodies. Using connective tissues, such as ligaments that connect bones and tendons that connect muscles to bones, our muscles move our skeletal bones by contracting and expanding. Most muscles work in pairs, where one contracts while the other expands in order to bend or straighten a body part. For example, if you are able to, bend your arm at your elbow and then straighten it. When you bend your elbow, your bicep is contracting while your tricep is relaxing. Then, when you straighten your arm, your tricep is contracting while your bicep is relaxing. As we went through the lesson today, we learned about the different types of bones and muscles that make up your skeletal and muscular systems. We also learned how they work together to make your body move. In our next lesson, we will study the nervous system. In that lesson, we will learn how the brain sends electrical messages to the rest of the body, including just how we get the message from our brain to the muscles so that voluntary muscles like biceps and triceps know when to contract and expand. Until next time, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. See you next time.